Hi, I'm Warren Martin. You join me here today at Chestnut Pools near Biggleswade. We're hopefully going to catch some carp on method feeders and pellet feeders cast into the island. There's a few key points that you get asked time and time again about these methods, so hopefully we can clear some of those up today. Let's get started. Two most essential things when feeder fishing to islands are how tight to the island you decide to fish, and then once you've decided that, how accurate you are in doing that. There's many things to consider. I've never been to this venue before today. It's very, very coloured, so I'm assuming that the fish will go into the shallow water so I can cast tight to the island, as tight as I can. Not definitely going to be right, but I'll start fishing tight. If you're getting lots of liners and indications but not many fish, then you can start moving your way back into the deeper water. As a general rule, if it's coloured, the fish will go into the shallow water tight to the island. If it's clearer, they'll feel a bit safer in slightly deeper water, so you can come further away. Obviously, I've decided that. I now need to clip up tight to the island. It's just a case of casting out, getting closer and closer and closer. Once you get to the point you want, clip up. The thing to remember is, before the match or before your session, you're casting with a bomb or an empty feeder. Once you load the feeder up, you're adding weight to it, so it will always go that little bit further. So before the start, don't clip up as tight as you want to fish. Clip up a little bit short, and then the extra weight with the lead will take, with the feed, will take it that little bit further. Let's get clipped up. Right, we're going to clip up now. It's probably a 40-45 yard cast, and the wind is awful, so I'm making my excuses now before we start. But it's quite a good whack, but we'll get clipped up just to the left of some sedges on the far bank. That's probably a metre and a half short, so we'll just take a bit more line off. Clip up. Remember, we don't want to get absolutely tight now because the extra weight of the bait on the feeder. But hopefully with that little bit of extra line, that should now put us maybe half a metre short of the island. Let's see where it is. Right, that's probably just about bang on. Just another 600 mil or so of line, and that'll now be perfect and ready to fish. Right, we're clipped up now. We know where we're casting. There's still one more thing to consider, and that's where and how you hit the clip. It's no good hitting the clip right back behind your head because you'll obviously be short of the feature. But similarly, it's no good hitting the clip with your rod straight in front because you're going to end up moving the feeder when you're then pulling your rod back to get it on the rests and moving a method feeder or a pellet feeder. You've just wasted a cast, it won't work. So what you need to try and do is hit the clip in exactly the same place each time, which leaves you just enough line to allow you to follow the rod down and put it on the rest without moving the feeder. So it's just a case of getting in a routine, really, of smoothly casting, hitting the clip in the same place, which means punching the feeder hard enough to make sure you can hit the clip in the same place, ideally at sort of a 45 degree angle, and then you can just simply follow it down onto the rest. So let's see if we can get it right. So good punch, hit the clip and down. Feeder's in the perfect spot, rod on the rest, nothing can move now. Started on a method feeder today. Your two options really are method feeder or pellet feeder. I tend to prefer a method feeder when I think I'm going to catch a lot of fish, they want a lot of feed, and they're going to come to the feeder quite quickly. I always feel a method feeder, once it's in the water, is fishing sooner than a pellet feeder. that can obviously, a pellet feeder in that case, can work to your advantage in colder weather, when you're waiting longer for bites, when you don't want to put quite so much feed in, sort of more winter, autumn time, smaller fish, F1s, the pellet feeder just is a bit more refined really. But I think we're going to catch plenty of fish today. It's coloured, we're looking for big fish, so I want to put a lot of bait in. And the fish, I think, will come at the feeder quite quick. So I think on days like today, the method feeder is the better option, really. So there we go, a nice mirror carp. Second chuck on the method feeder. Right, we mentioned method feeders and pellet feeders, and I mentioned that the method feeder is a more positive, quicker way of fishing when we're looking for lots of fish. Obviously with the method feeder, the bait disperses quite quick. It will spread over an area, not a massive area, but it will leave the feeder, spread around, leave your bait on top. For days when we're catching lots of fish and the fish are homing in on the feeder, I think method feeders are the way to go. To help that, the way I load my feeder, make sure that my hook bait's always very near the top of the pile. Basically, I just put a very small amount of feed in the mould, then I place my hook bait in, and then I fill it up. So when we then turn the feeder out of the mould upside down, my hook bait is right near the top of that pile, and the fish will be able to get to it really quickly. On good days, I think that's the way to go. The pellet feeder comes into its own on days when it's a little bit harder, it might be colder, we might be fishing for less fish, because what it produces is a much smaller, neater, compact pile of bait. It takes a bit longer to work and come out of the feeder, but once it's working, it is that little bit neater and there isn't the spread of bait. So days when the fish are a little bit cagey, don't want loads of bait, a tiny little neat pile with your hook bait in it, I think is better than the method, which is a bit more positive. It's very easy to swap and change between the two using the Evolution system. We just slide the rubber off, pull the line out of the slot in the back of the feeder, pull everything through, and then repeat the process with the new feeder. Drop everything through, line into the slot in the back of the feeder, tail rubber back on, pull it through. In 10 seconds you're now fishing with the pellet feeder. Got a 4-inch hook length of 018 power micron. Some people fish 2 or 3 inches, some people think 6 is better. My personal preference is 4, so 2 to 6 inch hook length basically. We've got a size 14 carp bander with the bait aligner. And all we do with that is use the pellet bander, open the band up, pop a pellet on, and we're away, ready to load up and fish. Just a quick mention about preparation, and this goes for any style of match fishing, not just method feeder fishing. It's always best to be prepared and a little bit of time, a couple of evenings a week, tying hook lengths up in a match can save you so much time. As I said, I prefer to tie mine 4 inches. You've got the different pegs for different lengths. There's one bang on 100 mil, ready tied 4-inch hook length with a bait aligner. Takes 5 seconds to get out and get your back fishing straight away. Right, before we cast out again, we'll just have a closer look at the bait aligner. It's something that's been taken from the specimen carp fishing world. Basically, you can see here, it just creates an angle where it comes off the hook that increases the gape of the hook and the amount of hook that's available to hook the fish, basically. You can see from the fish we've caught, they're all properly hooked, and that's purely because all the hook is free to hook them. It basically just kicks it off at the angle it should do, and it's a lot easier to tie than a hair rig. Right, probably the most important thing about method feeder and pellet feeder fishing is getting the bait right. The general rule of thumb is it wants to be on the drier side. As soon as you overwet your ground bait or over soak your pellets, they just won't bind together properly. Each ground bait, each pellet's different really, so it's trial and error, but always go on the drier side. You can always add more water if you need to, but you can't take it out. Pellets, with these 2mm Vandenine pellets, I just know from experience that they need very little time to be right. So basically I just put some in the tub, totally cover them in water, and they literally need 30 seconds. So while they're soaking, we'll do the ground bait. Again, drier is better. Don't need a lot. We'll just put that in the bowl. Traditionally with ground bait you add a little bit of water, mix it a little bit more, but with this krill it takes on a lot of water, so I basically give it a fairly good amount, give it all a stir in. So at this point it's too wet, but if you're doing this before you're tackling up, it'll dry out. Then all we need to do is put it through the riddle before we start and it'll be perfect. The pellets will be done now. So literally just drain all the water off of them. Again, you're doing this before you're fishing, so these will now have half an hour or so to sit. And by the time we start fishing, they'll be perfectly sort of tacky, but not soaked, basically. Right, we've left it for 10 minutes now to settle, and it should now all be ready to go. You can see the pellets have taken on a bit of water. They're not completely soaked, but what they are is now sticky enough to mould into a ball and go round the feeder. So they're now ready. As you see, they'll break down again, so they're still complete pellets rather than gone into a paste. I'll stick those in there. So that's pellets ready to go. Now we just need to riddle the ground bait. So very simply, riddle on the bowl, put it through the riddle, push the lumps through, and what we're left with there is a dryish mix that will go into a lovely ball, and that's not too sticky. It will come off the feeder, it won't get stuck in the mould. That's absolutely perfect. It's as easy as that. Right, so we've now got the baits ready. And that was the easy bit, because now we've got to decide what we're actually going to use. You can fish pellets on their own. If you do that, you tend to have to fish a pellet hook bait. If we use the ground bait on the feeder, that gives us the option of fishing dead maggots, corn, mini boilies, other baits. But I do generally feel when we're putting pellets around the feeder, it makes sense to fish pellet on the hook. There's no right or wrong. There's no hard and fast rules. One day it can be pellets, one day it can be ground bait. Today I've started on pellets around the feeder with a 6mm on the hook. Had a lot of liners, indications, a couple of fish, but I was getting a lot of liners for the number of proper bites I was getting. So I've changed over to ground bait, and almost immediately all the indications stopped. So that immediately shows you that it is a pellet day. It's not always that simple. It is trial and error. You can use a 50-50 mix of the two. Some days that'll be the way to go. But basically, have some ground bait, have some pellets, have another tin maybe with a mixture of the two, and just see which brings most indications, most action. Right, just a quick mention about loading the feeder. Fairly easy process with the squeeze and feed moulds. The only thing really you need to think about is whereabouts in the feeder you want your hook bait to be. With a hard bait, such as a hard pellet or a boilie, you can get your bait quite close to the top of the pile on the feeder. The problem with a softer bait, like dead maggot or corn, you need it to be slightly more in the middle of the ball, and that's purely because when we're compressing it, a softer bait nearer the bottom of the mould, i.e. the top of the feeder, you can squash them off the hook. So with a softer bait, I would probably fill the mould at least halfway before I put a soft bait in it and then top it up. With a harder bait, such as a hard pellet, I'd literally put a dusting of pellets in the bottom, then the hook bait, then the rest of it. Because it's a hard bait, it's not going to damage when you squeeze it. Then you're left with your loaded method feeder, and we can just see our hook pellet very, very close to the top of the pile. So within seconds of that going in the water, a fish would be able to get to that. With a pellet feeder, same as the method feeder, ideally we want our hook bait as close to the front of the feeder as we can, so it's accessible as early as possible, really. So it's a case, fill the feeder up just level with the surface of it, give it a squeeze, put our hook pellet on top, scoop through again, good firm squeeze this time, and there it is, ready to go. And within seconds our pellet will be on the top, falling out the feeder, ready for a fish to get to. Something to consider to make fishing easier is getting the correct rod and reel for the situation that you're facing. Today we've got a chuck of about 30 metres, so I'm using the Mark II 10-foot Carp Master. Nice and strong in the butt to punch the feeder and land big carp that sort of are averaging 7 or 8 pound. Nice and short, so when we go to net the fish, they're within netting range. Just an ideal rod for this sort of fishing, really. Matched it with a 4000 size Aquos. Fits perfectly with the rod, really. Not overly heavy, but powerful enough, wide enough spool to make the casting easy. And we've matched that with 10 pound in the new Carp Master sinking mono. 10 pound sounds quite heavy, which it is. It's obviously more than strong enough for the fish we're catching. But this particular line is very soft, very supple, so even on a 4000 size reel we can quite happily use it and be confident that it's more than strong enough to land anything we're going to hook. It sounds obvious, but one of the most important things about feeder fishing is to get yourself comfortable. Also where you angle the rod. There's a common trend at the moment for some reason to almost point the rod at the feeder. I don't like to do that because you're clipped up, you hook a fish and it goes, you've got very little give or leeway. I like to come round slightly at an angle just to give myself that bit of room to play a hooked fish. The other thing to consider is whether you hold your rod or whether you have your rod on a butt rest. If it's a hard day, say winter time, and you're waiting a long time between bites, then I would use a butt rest just because it's more comfortable. You can move around, you can do things without affecting the rod. Today, when we're catching a lot of fish and getting a lot of bites, I'm not loose feeding on other lines, so I don't need to do anything else. So it's easy just to have the rod across your knee and hold it. Telescopic feeder arm can be adjusted wherever you want it. A decent sized rod rest head. What we were talking about earlier about dropping short, maybe going tighter, with a rest of this size, you can actually do that via the rest. One cast, if you want to drop it shorter, you can stop it and have it there. You want to go tight, you can stop it and have it there. So that just gives you a little bit of movement without having to clip up, unclip, change things. With the mega feeder arm, there's no situation basically that we can't get comfortable and correctly set. For still water fishing, we're obviously always going to want the head lower down if we're fishing with a butt rest, or knee height if we're fishing across the knee. It will move horizontally quite easily, and by adjusting the top arm, if we were fishing on a river, you can get it to whatever height you want to get your line out of the water. There's also a cam lock to extend even further if you want to. So whatever situation, wherever you're fishing with this arm, you can get your rod correctly set. Right, well that was my last cast of the day. Hopefully a few of the hints and tips I've given you can help you go out and catch a few like this yourselves.